the bladder can contain. I understand that. Joshua chapter 2, verses 18 and 19. Behold, when we come into the land, thou shalt bind this line of scarlet thread in the window which thou didst let us down by. And thou shalt bring thy father and thy mother and thy brethren and all thy father's household home unto thee. And it shall be that whosoever shall go out of the doors of the house into the street, his blood shall be upon his own head. And he will be, and we will be guiltless. And whosoever shall be with thee in the house, his blood shall be on our head, if any hand be upon him. Today I want to share with you on the subject, the faith of Rahab. The faith of Rahab. Father, I thank you again for the privilege to stand before your precious people to share your word. I pray that this time will be a blessing, that you would speak prophetically as you have already begun. Let this word be applicable to the present scenario and what you are saying to Redemption Christian Center at such a point in time. The faith of Rahab. The book of Joshua is a book about the importance of faith. The book of Joshua was written by Joshua to record the conquest of the land of Canaan by faith. The name Joshua is in Hebrew is Yehoshua or Yeshua. Just change the J into a Y. Joshua and Jesus is the same name pronounced differently, but have the same meaning, which is Jehovah saves. The revelation of the book of Joshua is about how Jehovah saves. He saves through faith. Victory, conquest, success comes through faith in Jehovah. In the New Testament revelation, there is a progress so that not only does Jehovah save through faith, but he saves through faith in Jesus. Jesus is the Joshua of the New Testament. Not only that, but the Jehovah of the Old Testament and the Jesus of the New Testament are one. It is the same person. And therefore salvation is by faith in Jesus Christ alone. And all spiritual conquest, success, victory comes through faith in Jesus, the Joshua of the New Testament. He alone can take us into our eternal promised land. The book of Joshua shows that the entering and possessing of the land of Canaan, the land of promise, was not by Moses, who represented the works of law, self, but by Joshua, who represented faith and a type of Jesus Christ. Let me say that again. The book of Joshua shows that the entering and possessing of the promised land, the land of Canaan, was not by Moses, who represented the law, but by Joshua, who represented faith and was a type of Jesus Christ. Through faith in Jesus, Yeshua, through faith in Jesus, his sacrifice for us, the blood he shed, the atonement he made, through faith in that, we enter into the eternal promised land of heaven. And whatever we do here for Christ, whatever successes we have here in this life through Christ, are tokens of our faith that qualifies us for something greater. The miracles that are happening now, our obedience now, a testament to our faith in the Joshua of the New Testament, Yeshua. And that qualifies us to enter the ultimate promised land. The revelation is that the salvation of God, his saving power, comes through faith in Christ alone. So, we are talking about the faith of Rahab. This is my introduction. I want us to know faith is imperative. Faith is very important. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6 says, but without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. You see, Moses didn't get into the promised land because he represented human self-effort. Joshua means Jesus. Joshua means Jehovah is salvation. Jesus means the same thing. And remember, the first generation did not get in because they did not believe. So under Joshua, Joshua was a man of faith. And under Joshua, through faith, they will get in. The deeper revelation is that through faith in Christ, we will get to heaven. We will be successful. We will be victorious in this life and the life to come. And I'm telling you, this is something you need to understand. I want you to hear me good. As a Christian, faith is imperative. You must believe God. You must have trust in God. You must have confidence that, listen what it says, Hebrews 11 and verse 6, he that cometh to God must believe that he is. He's not a figment of our imagination. He's not a pictorial God. He's not just a historical figure. He is real. He is. He exists. God is real. That is why you and I are here. He created the world. He's real. God is real. I said, God is real. God is real. God is real. Get that? God is real. When we say God, it's not just G-O-D. It's more than that. We are talking about a real being. He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. We must understand this. We don't seek God in vain. We don't consecrate ourselves in vain. We don't obey God in vain. We don't obey God and say, go and march for Israel, and nobody wants to do it, and you go. It's not in vain. He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 38 says, now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. And this statement, the just shall live by faith, is repeated in Habakkuk 2 and verse 4, Romans 1, 17, Galatians 3 and verse 11. So four times the Bible says, the just shall live by faith. So if we are going to be successful, I'm establishing the point, we must have faith. What's this now? Deuteronomy chapter 32 and verse 20. You must get this. Mark this. It says, Deuteronomy 32 and verse 20, and he said, I will hide my face from them. I will see what their end shall be. Let me see how they will survive without me. That's what God is saying. For they are a very forward generation. Watch this. Children in whom there is no faith. Now, that word forward means fraud. It means fake. It means perverse and unacceptable. So, God categorizes people in two camps. Those who believe and those who don't believe. And those who don't believe, he refers to them as forward, perverse, unacceptable, fraud, fake, children in whom there is no faith. There are people who have no faith. But we are not such people. And we must not be such people. And if your faith is wavering today, let this message strengthen your faith. And together, let us believe God. Let us have faith in God. Jesus said in Luke 18 and verse 8, we always refer to it, and I like to refer to it, because in his coming, the Bible asks, Jesus asks one thing, would I find on the earth when I come? He said, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? Faith. He said, will I find faith? If faith is what God is looking for, I must ask you the question, then what are you looking for? If faith is what he values, what do you value? Listen to me. Faith don't mean you get all that you want, when you get it, how you get it. Faith means I trust God in spite of. I'm remaining faithful in spite of. You hear the testimony of Vicky, but you didn't hear the rejection she went through, hardship she went through. But she remained faithful and served God. And as my child, never went out and lived wild. Are you there with me? And then God could do whatever he wants, how he wants, when he wants. And so, we must understand the value of faith. There are certain things we do by faith, Brother Cohen. You do it not because you have the money. You do it not because you have the resources. There are things you accomplish because God tells you, go in that direction, move here, go there. She stepped out to believe God. Heart attack, urinary infection. I met the man was good, the man healthy, looking healthier than me. Young, about to fly out to Kenya. Next thing the man and drips in his mouth. What do you do in those times? You keep praying, you keep believing God. And all those times, Brother James and I up in the bush. And he said, Pastor, I'm standing with you, I'm praying. So while we're up there, praying, battles are going on there. But look at it now. Look at the mighty turnaround. Today, we are focusing on the faith of Rahab. I want to be quick. I want to share with you 5 ingredients in the faith of Rahab that made her faith genuine and powerful. 5 ingredients that should be in your faith. 5 ingredients that should be in the faith of all of us. Number one. Watch this. Number one, the faith of Rahab could not be hidden. Joshua 2, 1 to 3. When Joshua was about to conquer Jericho, the first thing he did, he sent spies to Jericho. And these spies went to the home of Rahab. Now, Rahab was a prostitute. Rahab was a lady of the night. Rahab was not sanctified. But Rahab heard about the exploits of Israel. She heard the gospel of the Old Testament. She heard how God
was with these people. She heard wherever they went, Jehovah went before them. Kings could not withstand them. Og, king of Bashan, they destroyed. Shihon, king of the Amorites, they mash up. They came through the Red Sea. They crossed the Jordan. And Rahab heard all of that. You see, although she was a prostitute, she was in connection with the news. She knew what was going on, because I guess when those men would come, she would inquire of them, so she had information. And because of that, she said, no, there's something with these people. The God of these people seemed to be the true God. And the Bible says, Joshua chapter 2, verse 1 through 3, Joshua the son of Nun sent out of Shittim two men to spy out, saying, go view the land, even Jericho. And they went and came into the harlot's house named Rahab and lodged there. And it was told, listen to this, it was told the king, somebody say the king, no small fry, it was told the king of Jericho, saying that, and the king of Jericho, let me read it again from verse 2. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, there came men in hither tonight of the children of Israel to search out the country. And the king of Jericho sent unto Rahab, the king, saying, bring forth the men that are come to thee, which are entered into thy house, for they be come to search out all the country. And the Bible says, now I want you to see that this is the king. This is nobody on the block. This is the president, the prime minister, the king. Say, bring out these men you have hiding there who came to you. And the Bible says, verse 4, and the woman took the two men and hid them and said thus, there came men unto me, but I wist not whence they are. She said, king, the men are there. She hid them. And she told the king, I don't know what you're talking about. These men left long time. I don't fix them up. Butter them up and send them on their way. You're talking about a prostitute. Think about, I want us to be real. Think about this situation. These were the words of the king of Jericho. Rahab's life would have been in jeopardy, and the life of her relatives. I'm talking about faith, but watch this. She hid the spies, but she couldn't hide her faith. True faith will hide some things, but true faith cannot be hidden. She hid the spies, and in hiding the spies, exposed her faith. In hiding the spies, as it were, it would seem that she risked her life. But in her mind, Brother Marlon, her faith said, no, I'm saving my life. If I don't hide them, I risk my life. Someone else who did not have faith would have said something else. Listen to me. What would you do in a similar situation today? I think I know what some today will do. If you were one of the spies in the home of some Christians today, they will say to you, brother, I understand the situation, you know, but you gotta have wisdom. Brother, you can jeopardize your life and mine. You had to use wisdom. As Brother Alistair used to say, today we want to be so balanced, we are balanced. But watch this, I am all for wisdom. But sometimes you just have to stand for the truth, stand for God, and that is your wisdom.
If you're not careful, we live when the rubber meets the road and it's time to make a stand. Then we talk ourselves out of it and talk about you need to have wisdom. Sometimes we just need to run on raw faith. Listen to me. I am all for wisdom. But at times, true wisdom itself demands that you stand for something. Rahab took a stand by faith to hide the spies. So here's my point again. Genuine faith cannot be hidden. She hid the spies, but not her faith. By hiding the spies, she exposed her faith. The faith of Rahab could not be hidden. Her faith was proven to be genuine by her deeds, by her works, by her actions in contemplation of God and who He is and what He can do and His ability and His power. It was not just work in herself, but her work was predicated on her vision of God and His power and the message she had heard about God and what He can do. And so there must come a time in your Christian life when after all is said and done and you have heard all the testimony and all the song and all the dance and all the shout, what do you do? Do you still stay standing at attention, or do you say, I'm going to step out, I'm going to bust a move, I'm going to do something for God? That is the faith I am talking about that cannot be hidden. I trust you will have such faith today. Number two, the faith of Rahab was confirmed by her testimony. Joshua chapter 2, 8 through 11. And before they were laid down, she came up unto them upon the roof. And she said unto them, you see, faith has a voice. Faith speaks. When you have faith, it comes out of your mouth. She said, oh Lord, I like this. I know the Lord have given you the land, and that your terror is fallen upon us, and that all inhabitants of the land faint because of you. It didn't happen yet, you know, but she said, I know. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, and that what you did unto the kings of the Amorites that were on the other side of the Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. I know all of that. And as soon as we had heard these things, our hearts did melt, neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, He is God in heaven above and in earth beneath. For the Lord your God is God in heaven above. She said, listen to me. I am not standing with those jokers. Don't worry about that king. He trembling in his boots. Is cowardly coward. Is fearful. I don't pick up the vibes. The whole nation then trembling. They know that God done promote you. God done exalt you. God done brought you through hell and high waters and through the wilderness. And because you obeyed Jehovah. Because when he said to march, you march. You went around Jericho. You did this, you did that. No, not Jericho, but the Jordan, sorry. We come into Jericho. But he said how to do it. Put the priest in front. Go into the water before it is parted. Don't wait for it to part. We heard how you came through the Red Sea. We heard how you mash up Og. How you destroyed Bashan. We heard all these things. And she said, I know my nation trembling. I am not joining with them. I am joining with you. We all got to come to that point. This was a faith talking. She said, we know. And I want to tell you, if you have faith, you will say, I know that God is God. I know that God is able. I know that Jesus can do it. I know that He is with us. I know there is no secret what God can do. I know Y'all, she said, I didn't plan this, you know. She said, I know God has given you the land. How many of you know God has given us the land with whatever is on the land? Look at the track record of the ministry. It's grow, we have to grow. It's move on, we have to move on. We don't claim it. We don't say it over and over. We got the power. Say yes. We got the power. She said, I know. She said, I've heard all these things. So I want to tell you this. Your faith must have a testimony. Your faith must have a confession. You can't have a faith that is dumb. True faith is not a dumb faith. True faith speaks and sings songs and testifies. Listen to this. Romans 10, 8 through 11. But what said it? The word is near you, even in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if thou shalt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thy heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whosoever believeth on him shall not be put to shame. Are you hearing me? The Bible says, with the heart you believe, but with the mouth confession is made. And the Bible said, Jesus himself said, in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 34, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So I come to tell somebody, what is in your heart will overflow through your mouth. If you come on, that's faith coming out there. I don't know what it is, but in the heart of something is telling me power is coming out. If you have faith in your heart, you'll confess it. I remember when we went to the restaurant, and Vicky said, she said, this is my last year with all you. I've taken you all out for dinner. The only thing is I was left to pay the bill. She said, Daddy, we're going to dinner tonight. He said, and this is my last. She said, this year, this is it. I was saying to myself, oh, I wonder what happened. She just said that, you know. And in a year's time, exactly what she said came to pass, you know. Listen to me, some of you need to speak. Open your mouth and speak. Say we going over. Say I'm coming out. Mommy, you coming out. I'm coming out with my whole family. I'm coming out with my brothers, my sisters. Thing ain't gonna be the same all the time. The dog coming out, the goldfish coming out. Come on, come on, come on. We ain't staying in this thing. We not staying down. We going forward. Forward ever, backward never. Come on, somebody. You got to speak it. Faith has a voice. And when you go, you say, I am a Christian. I am not like this. We don't do that. No, I stand for Israel. I don't want to get into any argument. All lives are valuable, but I stand with Israel. Faith has a voice. Faith speaks. Faith speaks. Faith tell the man that you're not married to can't touch this. Faith tell the woman that you're not married, that you're already married and she's tracking you. I'm married. Can't corrupt myself. Faith speaks like Joseph. How can I do this wicked thing and sin against God? Come on, I say faith has a voice. And God hears the voice of faith. The devil hears the voice of faith. And your voice will be respected in the spirit realm. The Bible says, for with the mouth confession is made. If thou wilt confess, the word confess there is homologos. In the Greek, homo means the same and logos means word. So homologos means speak the same word. Say what God says. Hallelujah. Agree with God. The Lord said you are more than a conqueror. The Lord said I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. The Lord said, behold, I give you power over all the powers of the devil. The Lord said, it is my will that you prosper and be in good health, even as your soul prospers. The Lord said, I want you to bear fruit, and I want you to bear it abundantly. The Lord said, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. The Bible says, this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Say what God says. Let a weak say I'm strong. Let a poor say I'm rich. Say
God says, faith has a testimony. Every genuine believer has a confession. Their words change from what they used to be. They don't say the things they used to say. Genuine faith, I say, overflows through their hearts and comes through their mouths. What was the confession of Rahab? She said, I know the Lord has given you the land. I know the Lord. The Lord is always in our confession. The Lord has changed me. The Lord set me free. And the Lord said in his word. And you begin to quote. Hallelujah. She said, I know. Listen to me. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 11, and they overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. It says they overcame by their testimony. They overcame by their words. They overcame by their faith. Glory be to God. I remember some years ago, a brother said, he sent me a love offering here of $1,000. He never came. He said, Brother Gil, I'm watching you. And this church that you have down there. No, this was my elder in my home church. This is Brother Anthony Lewis. Probably he's watching this morning. Right? And I came in here as a convert and got baptized. These guys had to buy baptismal clothes for me. Carry me up. And all we remember now, Nawani's in the crazy. Edmund, you're laughing. You must know that's joy, old school. That was joking about this. And he carried me and be a pair of shoes, pants, and a jersey to get baptized. And I'm telling you, it's in those days, glory be to God, we recognize what God can do, and his goodness. I was flowing along a certain line there, something I wanted to say, but it will come back to my mind. But I want to tell us, your faith must have a testimony. Your faith must have a confession. So this is what the guy said. It came back to my mind now. He said, Brother Gil, he said, what struck me about you? He said, while you were there as a convert, you said to me, Brother Anthony, you see how I'm looking now? I'm going to marry Tracy. And I'm going to go into Bible school. I'm going to go into the ministry. And I'm going to make a mark. He said, Brother Gil, everything you said is happening. Let me tell you something. When you pray, you go, spit and tears whole night. Let me tell you something. When that Holy Ghost rises up from your toe to your knee, to your thigh, and it hits your belly, bah! Then you say, I can make it. My life will be different. And you feel power coming out. Life. You feel like the words are created. Like the words going forth and taking a hold of things. The confession of faith. Brethren, as we yield ourselves to God, don't be afraid to say what God says. Don't be afraid to say what God put in your spirit. Don't be afraid to say, you know, I don't want to tell everybody on the job I'm a Christian because you know I'm at backslide. Say it. Say I'm a Christian. Say I'm holy. Say I'm never going to do that. Don't go tiptoe around secret. You're a secret believer. I'm not telling anybody I'm a Christian because if I tell them I'm a Christian, I can't go to that party there. I can't go to that cocktail. I can't sip Old Oak White with cherry and pineapple mix up as a cocktail with the ambassador for so and so and it's no.
I'll be at the side praying, and if there's no room for me to pray, I'll go in the toilet. I hear people say, when I had no room in my house, and I alone was a Christian in my house, and I wanted to pray, I went into the toilet. I went into the latrine, and when the Holy Ghost come upon me, all the scent went. The flies and the worms kept quiet, and all those cockroaches bowed their heads for the power of the Holy Ghost. I forgot I was in a latrine. I forgot about the scent, the power of the Holy Ghost. When the Spirit of the Lord came upon me, and from there I began to holler, I'm coming out of here. My God, I'm gonna have sauna. I'm gonna have a hot bath. I'm moving into hot and cold. Sometimes you don't even know what you're saying because God would not allow you to know. So he give you tongues, but the devil knows. My God, I said, we got a confession. Come on, lift your hands and say, yes. My God. I said, I'm going to be short, but hear me. The Bible says, Psalm 107 and verse 2. Hear what it says. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. Somebody say, oh, give thanks unto the Lord. Repeat after me. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. For he is good. For his mercy endureth forever. Let's do that again. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. For he is good. For his mercy endureth forever. Let's try it one more time. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. For he is good. For his mercy endureth forever. Hey! Hear the next line. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Whom he had redeemed from the hands of the enemy. Stop complaining. Stop murmuring. Stop grumbling. Stop being dumb. Say what the word of God says. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. For he is good. For he is good. He is good, 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 good. And for his mercy endure it forever. And then he said, let the redeem of the Lord say, let the redeem of the Lord say so. Let the redeem of the Lord say, oh, give thanks unto the Lord. Let the redeem of the Lord say, for he is good. Let the redeem of the Lord say, for his mercy endure it forever. Listen to me. If he redeem you, say so. If he has been good to you, say so. Let the redeem of the Lord. Somebody in the house, say so. Say so. Say so. Say so. Say so. I pray a say so anointing. Break forth in this church today. Hit this church. Somebody shout. Give God a praise. Give God a glory. Say, for the Lord is good and his mercy endure forever. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good and his mercy. Somebody say so. Say so. Say so. Say so. Say so. Say so. Let the devil hear you. Come on, it's time to begin to confess. Oh, give thanks. Has he been good to you? I say, have the Lord been good to you? Redemption. Redemption. Has the Lord been good to you? Oh, give thanks. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good and his mercy endured forever. Let the redeemer of the Lord stand to your feet. Open your mouth and bless God. This is a red letter day. Hey! I feel like I'm prophesying something. Don't wait until you see the miracle to say it. Say it now. For he is good. Give him thanks now. Woo. Hey! Hey, 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 hey. Oh, give thanks. thanks. Oh, give thanks. Somebody need to give thanks for your breakthrough. Somebody need to give thanks for your house. Give thanks for your husband. Thanks for your wife. Oh, glory be to God. Thank him for what you're not seeing. There's an anointing here. There's a breakthrough here. Thank him for the property. Thank him for the healing. Thank him for heaven. For the streets of glory. Yes. Thank you for raising up redemption in the nation. Raising redemption in the Caribbean. Raising redemption in the earth. Somebody throw your hands in the air and just give God praise. What God has done for Vicky is a token for all of you. So give him thanks. Give him praise. Hey. Hey. Take a seat. I gotta get. I have two quick points, and I'm finished. Hallelujah. Let the redeemer of the Lord say what? Say, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Number three, the faith of Rahab had an impact on others. I got to run through this quickly. The faith of Rahab impacted other members of her family. Joshua chapter 2, 12 and 3. Now therefore I pray you, swear unto me by the Lord, since I have shown you kindness, that you will also show kindness unto my father's house, and give me a true token, and that you will save alive my father, and my mother, and my brethren, and my sisters, and all that I have, and deliver our lives from death. My God, I want to tell you, true faith will have compassion on your family. True faith in your heart will touch your children. True faith will touch your mother. True faith will touch your father. True faith will touch those that are close to you. And sometimes it will touch those that are even outside of your family. Sometimes even your co-workers. In Acts chapter 16 and verse 31, Paul said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved and thy house. I want to tell somebody today, as you believe God, don't leave your family behind. Don't leave your husband behind. Don't leave your wife behind. Don't leave your mother behind. Don't leave your father behind. Don't leave your brother behind. Don't leave your sister behind. Don't leave your children behind. Take them with you. The Bible says to the fathers, he's in Ephesians 6 and verse 4, it says, bring up your children in the admonition of the Lord. Amen. Don't leave them behind. Wage war over them. Pray for them. Stay in the face of God for them. Amen. Commit all your children to God. They might be a little pulled back at some point in time, but continue to believe God that they will be baptized in the Holy Ghost, that they will be filled with the Holy Ghost, that even those who might stray will come back like the prodigal son. They will come back to God. They will come back to Father God. You have to keep believing. The Bible tells us in the book of Exodus chapter 10 from verse 8 through 11, when Moses was leaving Egypt, Pharaoh said, "Now who are you going to take with you?" He said, "Listen, take the men alone, but leave the children and leave the animals." And he said, "Because I know evil is in your heart, Moses. You all have some plan." He said, "But don't take the children with you on that plan." And what did Moses say? Go and read it for yourself. Moses said in Exodus 10 and verse 26, he said, "Our cattle shall go with us. There shall not a hoof be left behind." In other words, he was saying, everybody going. Tooth moon, tooth bagai. Nobody is staying in Egypt. belong to my family. Everybody serving God. We all will live for God. We all are going to leave Egypt and we're going to serve the true and the living God. When you started praying for your children, so all the devils on their job and their school trying to come against them, they have to back off, because you're on your knees, you know, while they are down there, wherever they are, in the school, on the job, wherever, and you are praying. Sometimes their mind want to go another way, but because of your prayer sought them out, you know. Your prayer captured them like Jonah. Amen. You're supposed to go down to Nineveh, you go in Tarshish, well, a storm coming your way, a Holy Ghost storm. And when the Holy Ghost storm come, hit you on the inside, hit you in your belly, you say, what I doing here? I'm going back to my father's house. I'm going back to the anointing. I'm going back to the truth. I'm going back. Why doing here with all this weed and bears? And why doing here with all this cussing and all this? This is not my turf. This is not my. I'm feeling a holy call. I feel a fire. Shut up with my bones. I got to get to the saints. I got to get to the church. I got to get to the place. No, this is not how I was brought up. And right now I know my mother and her niece praying. All this thing you all put it in my face. I hear in Rayadaba, Shakayaba, Kito, Leketo Shakiba. I'm hearing let it go. When they push it before you and you put out your hand, the Holy Ghost pull it back. You don't know how you pull it back. Derek Prince said he was in our service. He said, I'm not accepting the Lord. But his hand said something else. He said, I'm sitting down right here, and his hand shoot up like that. He said, you lifted your hand. Who, me? Really? He said, that literally happened. Saints of God, take your children with you. There is power in prayer. You see, children don't see the whole big picture, but we see the picture. So we have to pray for them. We have to intercede for them. Listen, faith, in the faith of prayer, finally, did I say two more? You could take a next one. Listen, the faith of Rahab acknowledge life and death. I got to close. I'm coming on 2 points. Listen. Joshua 2:12-13. Now therefore, I pray, swear unto me by the Lord, since I have shown you kindness, and that you will also show kindness unto my father's house, and give me a true token, that ye will save alive my father, my mother, my brother, my sister, and all that I have. Deliver our lives from death. This is the point. The faith of Rahab acknowledged life and death. You see, our faith is not about food and clothes. It's not really about things. At the end of the day, it's about life and death. Faith in God is a life and death issue. Faith in God is what separates the wise from the unwise. Faith in Jesus is what separates the visionary from the visionless. Faith in Jesus is what separates the living from the dead. Faith in Jesus is what separates the heaven-bound from the hell-bound. The matter of faith is a life and death matter. All the things that we get in between, these are fringe benefits. Faith saves from death, not just physical death, but eternal death. Revelation 21 and verse 8 says, but the fearful and unbelieving, the faithless and the abominable and the murderers and the whoremongers and the sorcerers and the idolaters and the liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. The unbelieving, those who don't have faith, will go into the lake. That, are you hearing me, saints? That burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Jesus said in Mark 8 and verse 35. Whosoever will save his life will lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel, the same shall save it. Revelation chapter 20 and verse 6 said, blessed and holy is he that had part in the first resurrection, for such the second death hath no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Those who believe shall reign with Christ, and upon them the second death hath no power. This is what we believe. This is what we believe. This is what we believe. This is what we stand for here in Love Until. We don't preach money here and prosperity and gimme, gimme, and so. Whatever so in here, it comes out of a genuine principle of faith. And I must reference my daughter again, because she, you know, the first one that got saved, when I began traveling to Venezuela, and she was a little, she used to kiss me all in my eye, my ears. I could never forget that. She was my joy. She was everything. And she was, you know, just a little cute baby. And that child grew and stood with us. And I saw her go through pain. Pain. But sometimes I don't know, her mother will know more, you know, because of the stand of her father in the land and the holiness and you know, disappointment with young men and so forth. But she never went out and disobeyed us. And she came and led the youth group. And I'm watching this child. She just believed in me, believed in her father. I tell you, when she went to Canada and everybody went to cinema, she said, my father said, I'm not to do that. And you're like, is this child for real? You know, although you know you set the standard, right? But you see, it was not about things. It was about making it to heaven and being a testimony to help others to make it to heaven. So it's nothing for God now to come and just raise her up and give her more than ordinary. I have never read a testimony like that in any book, anywhere. Never. But it's happening here as a token to you. I am saying it's not about house and land. It's about making it to heaven. It's about living holy, living right. Come out from the world. Come out from among them. We can get all these things. What shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? If redemption is going to come a big church, it must be God. If redemption is going to expand, it's going to be God. Because no way are we going to compromise for growth. It must grow on the truth. It must grow on holiness. It must grow on a standard. It must grow on no compromise. And I would to God that the day comes when he showed to this nation that my heart is pure and I'm genuine. I don't need to run down money to be blessed. Send the money from the east, the west, the north, and the south, and raise up a mighty church in Trinidad and Tobago that the prime minister, it would not be Rowley, might not be Rowley, but the prime minister will come there. Let love until means the vent. Let it be the vent. The vent, you know what a vent gives? Ventilation. Let it be the vent of power. The vent of life. From up the hills, bring the bad boys down. Let them put down their Uzi and their 9mm and the MR-15. Let them put down, my God, their weapon and take up a Bible. I pray that one day the Holy Ghost fire will go up the hills of St. Barb's, up the hills of Red Hill, and Lord, all up there, and arrest them and arrest them. The power, anybody with me? Hallelujah. They say, I don't know, but something telling me to go to that church down the road. Go to that church. Go bring the gondoleros. Riot up a shaka. We mash up every flag. We bust every calabash. All the and all the jinx. My God, the evangelists are going to be saved. They are yet to be saved right here in Love Until, because we got the power. I don't jam the Obia man. Mr. Obia man, I send back your power. Miss Obia woman, I send back your power. We got the power. We take the power. We take authority in the name of Jesus. Bring them from Bayshore. Bring them from Federation Park. Bring them from all over this land. We raise a standard in the name of Jesus. Our faith will touch others. Our faith acknowledges that there's a hell. and a heaven. It's about life and death. Finally, this is final but true. The faith of Rahab is a universal faith. I'm going to quick with this and finish. Chapter 2 and verse 17 through 19. And the man said unto her, we will be blameless of thine oath, which thou hast made us swear. Behold, when we come unto your land, because she said, look, I want you to save my mother, save my father, save my brother, save my sister. Save us from death. They said, when we come, hear what I'm talking to you, right? Hear what we want you to do for me. Hear what we want you to do for me now, boy. Just put a scarlet thread on your window. Let it hang down red so that we can see it. They said, thou shalt bind this line of scarlet thread in thy window, which thou didst let us down by. She said, the same window you let us down by to get away, put a scarlet thread there. And thou shalt bring thy father and thy mother and thy brethren and all that you have of your father's household home unto thee. And it shall be, whosoever shall go out of the doors of the house into the street, his blood shall be upon his own head, and we will be guiltless. But whosoever shall be with thee in the house, his blood shall be on our head. If any hand be upon him, we take responsibility. Oh Lord Jesus. So look at the message now. They said, listen, we're cutting a deal with you. Tell all your family, stay in this house and put a scarlet thread hanging out of the window. And whosoever stays in there, they will be saved. But whosoever comes out, if they die, we have no responsibility for that. My friend, I want you to know that the scarlet thread is Jesus. The scarlet thread is Calvary. The scarlet thread is the blood that Jesus shed. And hear the message. This scarlet thread runs all through the whole Bible. It is the lamb that was slain to cover the nakedness of Adam and Eve in Genesis. It is the Passover lamb in Exodus. It is the burnt offering in Leviticus, in Numbers. It is the serpent on the pole that represented Jesus. And in Deuteronomy, it is the one who hangs on a tree and is cursed to bring a blessing to others. Are you hearing me? So the message of the scarlet thread runs through the Bible. And the message is this: if you believe in the blood, you will be saved. If you believe in the blood, you will be delivered. If you have Oshanda, if you come under the blood, you don't need no red lavender, you don't need no katanga water, you don't need indigo blue, you don't need black sage, you don't need hops bread, you don't need a scissors under your pillow, you don't need coconut husks to burn. Are you hearing me, somebody? All you need is to plead the blood. Somebody say the blood. The blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary. For it reaches to the highest mountain and it flows to the lowest valley. Oh, the blood. Oh, the blood. Oh, the blood. Oh, the blood. That gives me strength from day to day. It shall never lose its power. I want the Obia man to know. I want Mother Quanox to know. There's power in the blood. I want Lavender to know. There's power in the blood. The blood of Jesus still has power. The blood of Jesus still heals, opens blind eyes, works miracles, provides money. The blood. There's power in the blood. What can wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood. What can make us whole again? Nothing but the blood. The blood of the bleeding lamb. The blood of Calvary. From the side of Jesus, I come to tell somebody, there's a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein. Sinners plunge me in that flow. Lose all their guilty stains. Say yes. Stand to your feet with me. Ooh. Hey. That scarlet thread is here today. Some of you are being delivered right now. No spectator, lift your hands. Ooh. Give him praise, come on. Let the redeemer of the Lord say so. That blood is for you. It's for your family. It worked for Rahab. It changed her life. She moved from a prostitute. She got married to Salmon. They gave birth to Boaz. From Boaz, Boaz married Ruth. And Ruth became an ancestor of Jesus. Rahab was in the ancestry line of Jesus. A prostitute. A lady of the night. If he could have done it for Rahab, surely he can do it for you. Say yes. Say yes. Say yes.